Hello, everyone. Hello, Council Manager, Minister Pia. Thank you so much for coming. And Pauline and Sebastian for here and respect for the wonderful song. I have to admit, when Audrey sent me the note asking if I'd say a few words today, I was a bit nervous because I tend to be a bit uncut in what I say. So when I think about the issue of racism and where we're at, I'd like to be optimistic. I'd really love to be optimistic. However, the work that I do daily tells me otherwise. And I thought, well, I'll come here today and I'll just share some of my thoughts with you and share maybe some of the things that are going on in my day-to-day right now to maybe give us a bit of a reality check about what is going on. Because I think in many ways, we can talk about racism. We could say it's out there, whether we choose to really engage with it, and whether we really choose to make the changes that we need to make in this society is the other question. I've been working at the John Humphrey Center for 11 years now, and I have to admit, when I started 11 years ago, I was pretty optimistic, pretty positive all the time about where things were. However, in some ways, I think we're going backwards, and I have really great concerns. And hence, when Audrey asked me for a title, I said, hate's rearing its ugly head in Alberta. So in December, I was elected the first female president of the Alberta Hate Crimes Committee. The Alberta Hate Crime Committee is a committee of law enforcement officers, community agencies, and individuals in Alberta who are committed to making a hate-free province. And when I was elected, I thought, what a time to get elected to this organization. Because I come from a rural community. I come from a place where we ride our horses every day, we live off the land. And what I'm seeing in my home community, I think, is an indication of where we're going and what's going on. So I'm just going to share a few thoughts with you. In this past year, we've seen a lot of political uncertainties. We've had shifts at both the provincial and the federal level. Everybody's going, what does this mean? It's exciting. And I think we're all embracing it in a way to open up conversations that we haven't had before. I think there's been an opening up of the space and a willingness to have the conversations that we have, that we need to have. However, there's still uncertainty as to where those two levels of government are going. And so with that, also brings fear. Couple that with the fact that in Alberta, we're suffering a major recession. That in itself brings profound fear. And it also brings profound instability. And it struck me recently, when I hear those stories of the 80s when people used to go into the bank and drop their keys on the bank's desk and say, I'm done. That's happening. I was in Lloyd Minster recently doing a workshop at the Friendship Center with young people and found out that that's what's happening in Lloyd Minster. People are walking into the banks and dropping their house keys and their car keys on the desk and going, I'm done. So this is bringing a whole other level of uncertainty and fear in our province. Couple that with the fact that when you think about the rural communities, I don't know if any of you know really that Drain Valley, for example, is a tent city popping up. People in my home community are experiencing an increased level of robbery and crime. There's all these things that are permeating underneath that are causing a lot of fear, they're causing a lot of uncertainty, and with that, what we see is we see racism raise its ugly head, because it is at that point when people start to be concerned about the other, about the xenophobia. We start to see maybe the people who've had it okay start to get a little bit unnerved about the changes that are happening. I've been sitting in circles recently where people have been angry at the level of support that we've been able to flood to the Sioux community. And the concern that from the Indigenous population saying, we are still struggling. We are still struggling to get off the streets, to deal with addictions, to deal with the things that we're dealing with on reserve. And we don't see the commitment. We don't see the support. It doesn't mean the Sioux community doesn't deserve it, but it really makes us question, where are we on all these things? If we're really committed to reconciliation, I'm concerned that the movement of reconciliation is only going to become a touch point of talking about racism, but not really embraced in changing the nature of how we live and work together. And so I have great concerns. Recently, I've been out working with the friendship centers across the province, talking about child intervention and talking about the challenges. If we are going to really embrace this reconciliation movement, if we're really going to start to look at the United Nations Declaration on the Indigenous People and embrace that and operationalize it within our public sector, within our day-to-day, we've got a lot of work to do. And I always think that maybe I've got a good grounding on racism. But every time I walk away from one of these conversations at a friendship center when we're talking about the issues and how children are still being taken away at alarming rates, it gives me great sadness. Because I'm concerned that we're not really ready to really look at things where they need to be looked at. So we're seeing racism rear its ugly head in terms of the uncertainty, people targeting other people in the community. When we met in the Alberta Hate Crime Committee, our first meeting this year, across the board, law enforcement said hate crimes are going up, but they're all against the Syrian Muslim community. We have cause to be concerned. So they're all against the Syrian Muslim community. One thing I do know is that our Indigenous brothers and sisters face a lot of hate, but yet they don't report hate crimes. So they're not registering on our agenda because they don't report. But there are reasons why we don't report. A lot of times we rely on these structures. Why don't people file complaints? Why don't they come to us with their concerns? Why don't they put it on the table? Well, when you're somebody who's been beaten up your whole life, that's the last thing you want to do. And the last place that you want to go is to a structure that represents everything that has oppressed you. So hence, we have so many issues that we have to navigate, which is really challenging. I'm going to close off to say, all of these pieces of the puzzle when we start to think about racism, and I was part of the Racism Free Edmonton movement here in Edmonton, which started out in 2004. Councillor Essinger mentioned that the city had 16 organizations committing to racism in Edmonton. However, as much as that seems lovely, over the past 3 years we have not met. We made no headway. We just hit roadblocks after roadblocks after roadblocks, and we never got anywhere. And that's what concerns me, is we come together, we have these conversations, but we never take them any further. There's not ever a real commitment to move things forward. It's about transactional politics. It's about, I have a four-year term. What can we get done? And we have to think beyond that. We as community agencies and organizations need to step up, and we need to start playing a role in working alongside the government and those who experience racism to really push the conversations. This is not to be horrible. It's not to say that elections or politics, it's horrible. It's about we need to redefine the spaces that we have these conversations in and where the ownership lies to take responsibility. Because what I've seen is that when we place responsibility only on the government to address racism, we're totally off the mark. Because it is up to all of us to take the change. And people within government want to affect change, but we need to work with them. And what I see is we don't. We're not effectively connecting and working together in a way that is constructive and in a way that repairs and renews relationships. Moving forward in this province, even in this country, I want a movement and a call to nonviolence. I want to live in a country that does not commit to selling arms overseas. I want to live in a country that chooses not to engage in violent conflict overseas. I want to live in a country where we can come together and we can get real about what racism is. Because racism is what one 19-year-old woman said to me last year, a First Nations woman on the street. We were talking about peace and she's like, I don't know peace. I don't know peace. I'm just struggling every day to survive. I'm struggling every day to protect myself as a young woman who lives in poverty. And the only services that are available to me are downtown and open me up to the possibilities of all these pure substance abuse, addictions, challenges. We really need to rethink things. So I call on us to really have these conversations, these challenging conversations. It's not easy. So I come here and I'm not very positive today. I wish I could be. But when I think about the Declaration of Rights of Indigenous People, and I think about what that calls for, I think about when we talk about child intervention, and they say that Indigenous organizations should be responsible for child welfare and intervention. 15 years ago, it was better than it is today. We've got work to do. I wish I could have all the answers, but what I think we do need to do is we need to build some collaborative partnerships. We need to have these conversations, and we need to get serious about shifting things, because to address racism, we have to shift. There has to be fundamental shifts to our systems, because individually, we can all embrace each other. But the way that our country is set up, it has been set up based on exclusion. And by learning our history and the depth of exclusion that has happened, not just to our Indigenous brothers and sisters, it is there, and it is formed that the way that we work together and the way that we are together. So I want to thank you for taking the time to listen to me today. Councillor Sinter, I know you're coming to the criminalization simulation March 24th. We've been working with a team of 15 young people in Edmonton who are building a simulation to show law enforcement, actually, what it's like to live in poverty and how you can become criminalized. And in so many ways that affects, it connects to racism. So if any of you are interested in their launch March 24th at 1 p.m., please let me know. But it is a challenging time, and I hope that we can all be open to each other. I think in these kind of times, we need to be open to each other. Often we're too quick to shut each other off. We're too quick to say, well, I'm a white girl. I'm a privileged white girl. Who the heck am I to speak? But it's time for us to get beyond that and come together in cohesive ways.